for the camp out. What do you guys think?
It was a chilly night.
A little bit.
Yeah.
One night for sure.
Yeah. Yesterday was 42 when I got
here. Yeah. But if you do August, it's warm at night, but it's cool. It's hot during the day.
Yeah, too hot. Yeah.
Yeah.
They only need two, like Friday night and Saturday.
You were there. Yeah.
For a week?
Yeah.
A week. We all stay up too late. Yeah. Come in. Maybe.
No.
Let's open this morning service by turning in our hymnals to number 241. Let's stand if you're able and sing, "I Sing of the Mighty Power of God," 241.
Peace. sing the goodness of the Lord, who filled the earth with food. He formed the creatures with his word, and they pronounced them good. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed wherever I turn my eye. If I survey the ground I tread,
turn to 374.
Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you and glorify your holy name because you are worthy, worthy of glory, worthy of power, worthy of honor. God, you are God, and we love you and we praise you and we thank you. Thank you for life today. Thank you for being able to be here together today. Thank you, Lord God, for waking us up this morning. Thank you that you don't leave us or forsake us, that you're with us forever. We thank you. We thank you that we're with you. And Lord, we love you. We praise you and we glorify your holy name. I pray that in everything that we do and say today, that Jesus Christ our Lord would be glorified. He would be lifted up in our thoughts, in our words, in our conduct. Lord, I pray that you would be glorified. And I also ask today for those, Lord, that are not here, that are traveling. There's many that are out traveling. There's some that are not well today. There's some that are not here today. Lord, in every case, Lord, please bless them, help them, strengthen them, encourage them in your word today to cling to you and to look to you. God, we give you thanks for all things because, again, you are worthy. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Now let's turn to number 401 and sing No, Not One. 401.
There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. None else could heal all our soul's diseases. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. No friend like him is so high and holy. No, not one. No, not one. And yet no friend is so meek and lowly. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. There's not a doubt that he is not near us. No, not one. No, not one. No night so dark, but his love can cheer us. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. Did ever saint find his friend forsake him? No, not one. No, not one. Poor sinner find that he would not take him. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. Was there a gift like the Savior given? No, not one. No, not one. Will he refuse us a home in heaven? No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one.
You may be seated. Happy birthday to Crystal Newkirk on September the 25th and Sheila Piper on September 28th. Now, there will be a very short worship team meeting right after the service today. Are there any announcements that didn't make the bulletin? In jest, I will say we cannot afford another weekend campout. Margaret and I went to Tumwater to to visit our older brother on Thursday, and I bought 12 rolls of paper towels, brought them here to the church, and last night we were down to two in each bathroom and one spare in the storage. Other than that, all the rest were gone.
They're gone now.
They're gone now, too. We must have forgot some bath towels and we're using paper towels, huh? I don't think we better ask anybody because I think they had too much fun.
No such thing.
Hey, did God bless with beautiful weather or what? Yeah. I was listening to the news last night, and that lady said, from 4 to 5 this morning, start raining, pause, from Seattle north. And she hit it for once. Let's have prayer for the offering. Our dear gracious Heavenly Father, we truly thank Thee for the blessings that You bestow upon us. Lord, we pray for the offering this morning, that we could further Your work both here and abroad. We think of our missionaries all around the world, Lord, serving You, spreading the good news. And Lord, we just pray that You'd be with them, protect them, guide them. And we just thank You that we can support them and pray for them. Lord, bless each one now, I pray today, in Your holy name. Amen. To number 463. Those of you who are able, let's stand and sing More Love to Thee, O Christ. 463.
Hear Thou the prayer I made on bare
seated.
Too busy turning to the fifth hymn.
Well, praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
God is good. God is good. Amen?
Amen.
All right, good. You're with me today on that. Praise the Lord. That'd be a whole Bible study that we'd have to do immediately if you guys didn't say amen to that. Okay, well, as you notice, a few things around the church today, you'll see some of these. And if you were here Friday, you know about this. The kids challenged from last Wednesday, and they wrote scripture from Psalms 119, verses 89 through 90, and they put them everywhere. So it might be fun for you to search around and see where they're at. You'll find them everywhere around the church, in cars sometimes. And how they get into cars, they had to have been somebody cooperating. And praise the Lord. Well, we had a great time to camp out. I do say that God has really blessed in that. And if you have a chance next year to come out, you should definitely do that. It's so much fun. We got to hear about a missionary, Brusco, and it was a wonderful testimony, actually, to hear about his life and the things that God had done through his life in South America. And he is one of those missionaries that he felt the call of God to go, and nobody would support him. No missionary organization would sign him up. So he just went into the jungle to a tribe that was known to be extremely dangerous and would kill people that would go there. And he was like, he wanted to go meet these friendly Indians. And so he ended up being out there for years and years, God doing amazing work and bringing the Lord Jesus Christ to these people. And that's the most important thing. It was wonderful, wonderful testimony. If you have a chance to hear about him, definitely do that. Well, praise the Lord. So today, if you remember last week we were in the book of Hebrews, and we were talking quite a bit about Jesus being the high priest after the order of Melchizedek and how that all comes together. And we're not done with that, but we need to step back a little bit just for a minute this morning, and we're going to go to John chapter 17. Amen. And then we're going to go to the Lord in prayer after you all get to John chapter 17. Let's pray. Dearest Heavenly Father, we do thank you once again for just the opportunity to get into your word today. Your word is life to us. Your word feeds us. Your word guides us and directs us. Your word gets us to think about things the right way. Your word, Lord, is so important to us. You've exalted your word above your own name. And Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you that you've given such importance to your word. We need to give such importance to your word. We love you. Lord, we love you so much, and we thank you for what you've done, and we thank you for what you're doing and what you're going to do. Lord, I pray that today in the reading of your word that you would feed every hungry heart, that you would touch every heart, every mind with your word today. Lord, we ask that you would bless it to our hearing. In Jesus' name, amen. John chapter 17 is a prayer of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ before he went to the cross. This is a prayer from his heart to his Father that we get to hear. Jesus prayed a lot of prayers in the scriptures in the New Testament, but this one right here stands out among everything else because it shows his heart towards his Father and towards those that follow him. And I really think that we have to see this. And we talked about him being our heavenly high priest, but that came at a cost, you know. He went to the cross. And I want you to see the love that he has in this chapter that enabled him to go there, enabled him to pay that price for us, enabled him to endure the suffering that he endured for us. So let's go to John 17. We'll read it through and then we'll come back and talk about it. These words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee and the only true God and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. I have glorified thee on earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. For I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. All mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee. Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. And now come I to thee. And these things I speak in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me I have given them, that they may be one even as we are one. I in them, and thou in me, and that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them, and hast as thou hast loved me. Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me, and I have declared unto them thy name, and will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. You know, we see this heart of the Lord here in this chapter. We see his prayer to the Father. He's not holding back his love, his thankfulness to the Lord, but you see his servant heart too in this, how he served his Father. He came here not to do his own will, but the will of the Father. This is something that he's showing us in our lives, how we need to walk in obedience to him and to his word. He's showing this. Back in the verse 1, he says, these words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. You know, this was the time. This was the time that he was going to go to the cross. This was the time that he was going to become that sacrifice for our sins, that one sacrifice for sins forever. This was the time, that perfect sacrifice. He had obeyed the Father in everything that he was sent to do. He completed that work that he was sent to do. And it also says here, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. The Lord Jesus Christ is capable of giving you eternal life. If you put your faith and trust in him as your Savior, you can have eternal life. He is empowered to do so. He has been given that by the Father. The Bible bears witness to that when it says that God is not willing that any perish, but all come to repentance. God wants people to repent and come to faith and trust in Jesus Christ. This is how we're supposed to live our lives, in dependence upon him. We need to depend on him. We need to follow him. We need to listen to him. It says here in verse 3, and this is life eternal. What is life eternal? This is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. The Bible says that God is a spirit. Those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. You can't come to God, you know, without coming through Christ. You need to come to the Lord Jesus Christ, and then you can know God. You can know him. This is an amazing thing. You don't have to wonder what God is like. You can know him. When you come to faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you'll go to his word, you get to understand what God is all about, who he is, what he wants, what he desires for you in your life. This is an amazing thing, that you can serve him, that you can live for him, no matter where you're at, whether you're in Centralia or whether you're in the jungle or whether you're in the desert or whether you're in the Arctic, you can serve God anywhere. You could be in space, serve the Lord. Amen? Just don't stay in space. You can't breathe easy there. Okay. Okay, he says, I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. He finished the work. Now, he was about to go to the cross. And in John chapter 19, if you go over to John 19, verse 28 through 30, it says this, and this is Jesus on the cross. He says, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he saith, I thirst. Now there was set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled the sponge with vinegar, and they put it upon a hyssop, and they put it to his mouth. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. He bowed his head and gave up the ghost. Not only did he finish the earthly work, he finished the work on the cross. He finished the work of delivering, saving us from our sins. You know, when he died on the cross as a perfect sacrifice, there was 3 days later, there was coming a time where he was about to rise again. 3 days later, he rose from the dead, conquered death, conquered the grave, guaranteeing to us eternal life. Faith and trust in him guarantees that. If you try to get eternal life through your works, maybe you work really hard and you do all these things, you're never going to work your way to heaven. You never work your way to eternal life. It's only through faith in Jesus Christ. Trust in him. Trust him. Let's look further. Back of John chapter 17, verse 5. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. You know, if you want to know about the eternal nature of Christ, well, it's right here. Before the world ever was, he was with God. We can go to Genesis. Remember Genesis chapter 1? You guys remember that? First chapter of your Bible? Genesis 1, it says this. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The heaven and the earth. It says this is how it was. God did this. Now, when you look at that word God, Elohim, that's a plural. It's not a singular. God, plural, and you're like, what do you mean? Well, if you look at verse 26 in Genesis chapter 1, it says, and God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. That's plural. Why is it? Because it's the Father and the Son. Eternally, they've been together. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as we find out through the Scripture. But you see this eternal relationship. Before the world was ever made, they were together. The Trinity, these, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, always together. Jesus is talking here in verse 5, and now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. Then if we go over to verse 6, it says, I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. This is one of the most important things, and it's a distinguisher of a person that's following Jesus Christ. Are you following his word? Are you keeping his word? It's easy for us. It's easy for us to say with our mouth, I love Jesus. You know what? It was easy for the Jews in Jerusalem, in the temple, to glorify God with their lips, but their heart was far from him. You see, your words and your actions should match. They should meet up. They should agree with one another. If your words and your actions don't match up and they don't agree with each other, then there's a problem. The problem is not with God, it's with us. So when you find that in your life, repent, ask his forgiveness, he'll forgive you, and then get your actions to match up with your words and move forward with him. Amen? When we speak words, we're speaking his word. You know, when we talk about, we're talking about our thoughts on how things are in the world. You guys look around at the world right now and you say, oh, there's this, there's that, there's this going on. Well, what does God say about it? This is the way that you're supposed to react to everything, to the culture that's around you, to the world that's, to your neighbor when you're talking to them about the Lord and they have their ideas about, you know, the way it should be. You need to give them what God said about it. I noticed earlier this week, I talked to a gentleman, and it was interesting because this gentleman it wasn't just me, it was me and Marcia, we were talking to him, and this gentleman had a lot of ideas, lots of ideas about how things were. Some of the things that he thought about were so, and then some of them were way off. And as we talked, it was interesting as he started to try to introduce some thoughts of man, I would say. He started introducing these things that weren't right. When I stopped him, I said, hold on. This is what the Bible says. And then rehearsed to him exactly what Scripture says. And it was interesting how he listened. He stopped talking. He wasn't not paying attention. He was paying attention. He was listening, and it was as if, as you speak the word of God, and I want you to understand this, when you're speaking God's word to a person, this is, they're hearing from him through you, but it's all about him. He thought that he knew how things were, but he didn't, because he's still walking in darkness. And until you come to Christ, you are walking in darkness. But after you come to Christ, your eyes are opened, you can see clearly, and then when you read God's word, you understand it, and you're able to relate it to someone else. The whole point of it is for you to be able to tell somebody about Jesus. Why is that important? Amen? It's vital to everyone, right? Let me ask you a question. If you have 100 people born, how many are going to die? 100, right? I mean, that's reality. We all are going to die one day. We're all going to go somewhere one day. And if you have Jesus Christ, you have assurance of knowing where you're going. But in our walk with him, as the disciples did, they kept his word. We need to keep his word. We need to abide by his word. We need to live in his word. We need to walk after his word. We need to talk about his word. We should be talking about his word. We should be thinking about his word. We should be meditating on his word. Meditating is just thinking about what he said. This should guide us and direct us in our lives. Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. For I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. You know, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, Romans 10:17. We know that this is where we hear the word of God, this is where faith is built in our heart. But if you're not communicating the word of God, then you're just communicating your thoughts. Well, your thoughts are not going to save anybody. Your words are not going to do that, but God's word does. God's word is his word is that sharper than any two-edged sword that, you know, that pierces to the dividing of the soul and spirits, the joint of the marrow. It gets to the root of the matter. It gets to the very heart of mankind. God's word. God's word penetrates deep into our hearts. Doesn't matter what culture you came from. Doesn't matter what the color of your skin or the language you speak. God's word will penetrate your heart. It'll get to the root of the matter. And the root of the matter is sin. You must be born again. You must have eternal life. If you have Jesus, you have life. But if you don't have Jesus, you don't. This is the message of the gospel. God wants you to have life. That's why he sent his son. He's the greatest gift ever given to mankind. There's no greater. than the Lord Jesus Christ given to mankind to save us from our sins. And if you reject that free gift, what are you saying to God? Can you imagine? Can you imagine going to somebody's birthday party and you go to them and you have, and you work hard for, maybe you worked hard for months and you said, I have this perfect gift I want to give them. It's perfect, but you know, it took you a lot of labor and a lot of effort, and you're able to go and get this gift, or maybe you put it together, maybe you made it, handmade it. And you take this thing that you labored over and you worked at and you bring it to this person, and they say, I don't want that. How would that make you feel? It'd be heartbreaking, wouldn't it? How much greater do you think it is for God to send his own dear son to pay the price for our sins if we reject that price? If we reject him. It's saying all that effort and all that pain and all the suffering that you went through on the cross, I don't want that. I want to make it there on my own. I'm going to get to heaven, you know, pulling up my own bootstraps. No, you won't. No, you won't. There's one name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved, and that is Jesus Christ. If you don't come through the door, you're a thief and a robber. You need to come in through the door, and the door is Christ. You need to hear his word. You need to obey his word. You need to walk in his word. And you need to tell people about his word. Have a passion and a love for your neighbor that will not allow you to keep silent, but will drive you to tell them the truth about Jesus Christ. He says here, he says, verse 9, I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. I want you to know that's good news. When we talk about him being a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek, understand that he is in the presence of God interceding for us all the time. He's there right now, interceding for you. And the great news here is he says, I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. You put faith and trust in Jesus Christ, you belong to God. And Jesus is interceding for you today at the right hand of the Father. That means in your failures, he's praying for you. When you don't, when you come short, and he knows that, he's praying for you. In those times you need strength, he's praying for you. In the times that you feel weak, he's praying for you. Understand, your heavenly high priest is performing a function in heaven. He's interceding for you right now. There's a day coming where we're going to be reunited. We'll talk about that in a little bit. He says here, verse 10, and all mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them, and he should be glorified in us. You should glorify Christ in everything that you do. Remember what he's done for you. Get joy in your heart for what he's done. Glorify him. How can you best glorify God? How can you best glorify him? Obey his word. Do what he said. That's how you can best glorify God. If you live a life that's contrary to his word and you say, yeah, I'm living for the Lord, it doesn't match up if you're not obeying his word. Our obedience to him is not because we're trying to work our way to heaven. It's because we love him. We love him. That's why we obey his word. Your kids, if you have children, your children, you know, hear you parents say, you know, kids, can you do this or take care of that? And the kids do that out of their love for their parents. Should be. Amen. He says, and now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee. Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. Now, did you notice that? He's asking the Father to keep them through his own name, that they may be one. The church is one in Christ. Even though we're many members, even though we're all different, even though we have different ideas about this or that and the other, let me tell you, we're one in Christ. We are one. We are family in Christ. We are all together, each one of us important. There's no least important part of the family. We're all important in the family of God. And every one of you has a purpose. Every one of you has an important role in the body of Christ for you to do for the Lord, every one of you. And God keeps you through his own name. That's good news. That's good news. There's no unimportant parts. They're all important. We all have a role to do. We all have a responsibility given to us by God. He has gifted you to do it, then do it. Amen? He puts it on your heart to go into the jungle, to go meet the friendly tribe that wants to kill everybody. Then if that's what God has put in your heart to do, then go. He'll take care of things. And if it's your purpose to glorify God in death, then so be it. That'll be the way it is. If it's your purpose to glorify him in life, that's the way it'll be. He's in control, we're not. He's driving the car, we're not. Amen? Get in the trunk. That's what I'd say. Don't be a backseat driver. Don't try to tell God what to do. He already knows what to do. You just need to hang on. You're going for a ride. Trust him. Amen. He says this. He says, verse 12, while I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. And he's talking about Judas, who's called the son of perdition. He's not the actually only one who's called the son of perdition. The Antichrist is also called the son of perdition. It's kind of interesting, the comparison between Judas and the Antichrist. Judas walked with Jesus for that time that Jesus was doing ministry. 3 years, he's walking with Jesus, yet he never belonged to the Lord. Don't let that be you, okay? Don't come to church for your whole life. Don't come to church for your whole life and not know the Lord and then die and miss heaven. Don't do that. If you come into church, then get in. Get all in. When you get baptized, you know what? When you get baptized, it's supposed to symbolize what's already happened in your heart. But let me tell you, you don't come up there and dip your toe in the water and be like, okay, I'm done. No, no, no. Jump in. Get all in that water. Amen? And in Jesus, that's how you should be. Why be reserved? Why? Doesn't even make sense. If you're a Christian, then be that. He's changed you. He's given you new life. Then be that. Get out there and tell the world about him. Live for him. Not that you're better than anyone else. It's not about that. It's that you have been saved, that you have been forgiven, that your sins are washed in the blood of the Lamb, that you have a reason to rejoice. Get in that. Don't be dipping your toe in the water. Doesn't even make sense. You know, and the sad fact of it is that there are people that are doing that, that are coming to church on Sunday as an outward form that, oh, this is what we're supposed to do, and we come in here, and then no relationship with Jesus. It's tragic. Shouldn't be that way. To be right there where you could take hold of life and you don't. And you miss him. How many are in hell today? How many are in hell today that are just wishing and hoping that they had just one more chance to do it right? One more chance to go back. And there's no chance to go back. The decision you make about Jesus Christ on this side of heaven while you still breathe in your body, that is the decision that is eternal. If you leave this world without Jesus, you're lost. And there is no hope. And there is no coming back from that. But if you leave this world with Jesus Christ as your Savior, you have life, eternal life. You get to be with him forever. Your heart should yearn for him. Your heart should desire him. You should be looking for Christ. You should be waiting for that day. Not idly waiting, but you should be looking forward to the day that Jesus comes back and you get to see him face to face. You should be looking forward to the day that he brings you home. You should be looking forward to seeing him. You should be excited and say, praise God, I get to see Jesus. Praise God, there's a day coming where I'm going to be in his presence forever. Nobody's going to take me from his side. Nobody's going to take me away from him. I get to see him. There's no more tears. There's no more sorrow. There's no goodbyes. It's only life and that eternal. That should be our desire. That should be our hunger. That should be what drives us to go forward, no matter the circumstances of life. Of course life is difficult. That's okay. Jesus went through more than you will ever go through. It's okay if life's so hard. It's all right. He understands what hard is. He knows what difficult is. He did it for us. Verse 13 says this, "And now I come to thee, and these things I speak in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves." You know what joy does? Joy tells you that despite the circumstances, I'm going to rejoice. The joy of the Lord is our strength. The joy of the Lord is what propels us forward. Even when our bodies are worn out, tired, even when our emotions have been wrecked, joy will keep you moving. Joy that's set before you. You can do all things through Christ, right? That strengtheneth you. Remember that scripture? I can do all things through Christ. Do you know what he was saying before that? He was talking about the things that he had gone through, right? Apostle Paul, stoned, shipwrecked, beaten, right? Not just once. Most Christians would give up as soon as somebody does, you know, unlikes them on Facebook. Well, guess I can't witness anymore. They unliked me. Seriously, that's not persecution. Count the cost. Count the cost. What's the cost of you not being obedient to God? What's the cost of you not following him? What's the cost of you not giving your life fully to the Lord Jesus Christ? What's the cost? Think about it. God wants you to think. That's why he says, "Come now, let us reason together." He wants you to think. Don't empty your head at the door. Think. But think right. Think eternal. This world's going to get burnt up. If all your eggs are in this basket, you come out with nothing. Think eternal. Make preparations in your heart, your mind, for the long-term plan of God here. He is not willing that any perish, all come to repentance. He is holding off his wrath for the day of wrath. That means he's giving us time. Time to do what he called us to do, to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He wants you to share the good news. Even if you fumble and stumble in your words, share Christ. It says here that, verse 15, "I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world." Did you get that? You are in the world, but you're not of the world. You are here, but if you belong to Jesus Christ, your home is not this world. You have a home in heaven. You have a home. You are an ambassador for Christ on this planet. You no longer, you've changed residence. Even though your physical body is still here, you've changed residence. Your nationality is not America, China, the Middle East, or whatever. That is not your nationality. You belong to Christ. You belong to the heavenly kingdom. That means that your brothers and sisters around the world, in every generation, they're your brothers and sisters in Christ. We're all one family. No matter what nation we happen to be born in, you are born again into a heavenly nation, heavenly kingdom. Do you get it? You're not of the world, just like he was not of the world. He goes more into this. "Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth." Why is the word of God so important? Because it's the truth. And he wants you to be sanctified through the truth. What does he do? He makes us more like Christ by his word. He gets us to think right. He gets us to act right. Amen? It's the word of God that straightens us out. The word of God. Grandma might have been good with her ruler, right? But God's a lot more effective. Amen? Because he changes the heart, and then he changes the mind. The ruler could never change the mind. It only restrained your actions. But God changes you here. Here first, here second. You start thinking about things the right way. That's what he wants for you. He says, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. He does it through the word of God. He does it through, you have a Bible in front of you, don't you? This is what he uses to change you, his word. That's a good thing. Amen? It's not a membership to the church. It didn't, signing up on the membership roll didn't change you. Amen? The particular denomination that has the signboard out in front of your building, that doesn't change you. Doesn't matter. What matters is his word. That's what matters. That's what changes us. That's what we need to be standing by, his word. That's what we go after. We follow him in his word because his word has the ability to change us. And we need that, each one of us. Amen? If you look at your life right now, those that you've been Christian for a while, look at your life. Are you different than you were? Are you different? You should be. And as you follow Christ, you start looking back, and I've done this a lot of times, so I hope I'm not alone, it'd be weird, but okay. So I look at my life, I look back, and I'm like, oh man, that was terrible. What was I thinking? And how often is that for us? Where we look back at our lives and we're like, okay, yeah, no, that was not right. You know, because as you follow him, he teaches you and shows you. He sanctifies you. He gets you closer to him. And we're not where we need to be. We're not done yet. But he's working on each one of us. He is sanctifying us with his word. That's why we need to learn, oh, one of the fruits of the Spirit is what? Patience, right? Patience with ourselves, obviously, we need patience, but with others too. Everybody's growing in Christ. Everybody's at different places. Some people have grown more in this area than this area, and some people have grown this area than this area, and some people are gifted in this area. Listen, we're all growing together. Exercise love, patience, kindness, gentleness, meekness, temperance, long-suffering. Exercise those. You kind of know some of those things, you know. And now, as thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. You've been sent. You've been sent. Remember Isaiah? The Lord says, who will go for us? Here am I, send me. You've been sent. The Lord gave a command. A command. He commanded us to go into all the world to preach the gospel to every creature. Guess what? Centralia is part of the world. Lewis County is part of the world. Washington State is part of the world. It happens to be the part of the world that God has placed you into. You're here. It's there. What's the holdup? What's stopping us? If 12, it was 11, then 12. Turn the world upside down for Jesus Christ. What more in this room today? We have more than 12 here. We have enough to bring the gospel to everyone in this county. We have enough to bring the gospel to everyone in this state. Doesn't mean they'll all receive it, but it is most certainly our duty to go plant and to water. God gives the increase. He's the one that causes the seeds to grow. We got to put them in the field. We have to. And if we don't do that, we're derelict. Derelict. We're not doing our job. Amen? And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. What he did for us. He had to be the perfect sacrifice. He had to keep the word of God perfectly. He had to keep the law. All 631 ordinances of the law had to be kept perfectly. He did. When he died for us, the law was fulfilled in him. Now he is the author of a new covenant for us, the New Testament, by his eternal life, because he lives forever. He gives us a new life. He sealed this new covenant. The old covenant is past. The new covenant has been given to us. This covenant is in Christ, and it's by faith in him and in his blood. He says here, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. He prayed for you. He prayed for you. You know, sometimes you can look at that and you say, oh, well, this was just for the apostles. You can't say that now, because he included you in that prayer. He says this, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. The reason so important for the unity of the church, and I'm not talking about the church that professes Christ but doesn't possess Christ. I'm talking about the church of Jesus Christ that has put faith and trust in him as Savior. The church needs to be one, because this is an evidence of what God has done. This is a proof to the world that this is real. If you don't walk in unity, you know, and I'm talking about professing and possessing Church of Jesus Christ. There is a false church out there. There's a church out there that says, oh yeah, we follow Jesus, but they're not following his word. They're not putting faith in Christ. They're doing it by works, by working their way to heaven. You can't do that. It is by faith in Christ alone. You can't add to what he's done. But when you have faith in Christ, then you should work for him. Get it right. Amen? I'm going to make it real easy for you. Anybody ever bake a cake? I know there's some back there to bake a cake. So let me ask you, cake authorities, because Marcia would tell you I'm not a cake authority. But cake authorities, let me ask you a question. You have your baking pan, right? Do you put the baking pan into the oven and start cooking it before you've ever mixed your ingredients? It wouldn't make sense. If I put a pan in the oven and said, okay, my cake is coming. Well, have you put the ingredients? Have you mixed them together? No, I haven't done that. But that cake's going to be good. You're waiting for something that's not going to happen. There's not going to be any cake. All you're going to get is a hot pan. Understand this. That you have to mix the ingredients first. They have to be mixed up, and then they have to be put in the pan. The pan has to be put in the oven, and then out comes the delicious cake. Amen? Get it right. Because getting it wrong is going to, it's not just going to be disappointing, it's going to be tragic. Faith in Christ is first, then obedience to Christ. Then you have the delicious cake, and his word is delicious. Have you tasted to see that the Lord is good? Amen? It says here, I in them, and thou in me, and that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. Let me tell you, guess where you're going? Guess where you're going? Jesus gets his prayers answered. I'm excited. I'm excited because I know he gets his prayers answered, and his desire is that we are going to be with him. I love, let's read 1 Corinthians real quick. Just hold your place there. 1 Corinthians 15, just this promise. This is wonderful. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, all the way to verse 51. First Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me just tell you something. Victory is coming. There's a day coming where the Lord is going to sound that trumpet, and guess what? You're going to be changed. Your body is going to be changed, and it's no longer going to be corruptible. It's no longer going to be breaking down and not working anymore. It's going to be brand new, and it's going to be in Jesus. We're going to be with him forever. He's made you kings and priests unto our God. We're going to be serving the Lord forever. It's a fantastic thing. Eternal life. Joy unspeakable, full of glory. You know, I'm going to tell you, that is the point of life. That is the purpose of life. To have life, God offers it to you. He's going to change your broken down body one day. That's going to happen. Whether you're in the grave already, that's okay. You'd be just like Job after skin worms have eaten your body. Then with your eyes, you're going to behold your Savior. You're going to see him face to face. I promise you this. If you love the Lord Jesus Christ and he is your Savior, you're going to see him face to face one day. You're going to be in his presence forever. And guess what? The good news is that all of us who put faith and trust in Jesus Christ, we're going to be there together. We're one family. It's going to be the biggest family reunion you have ever seen. Every nation, tongue, and language will be gathered together around the throne, giving God the praise and the glory for what he has done. And you get to be there. That's good news. That's the best news. Don't you want others to come? Don't you want your friends and neighbors and family? Don't you want everyone that you see to know about this great love that God has and this great reunion that he's going to have one day? Tell them. Tell them. That way they can go too. Tell them. It's the best news. He says this, O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me. And I have declared unto them thy name, and will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. That same love, the Father loves the Son, can be in you, if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. That is great. That is a great promise. Did you see that? The love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them and I in them. You have the capacity to love one another. You have the capacity in Christ to do that. Do it. Love one another with that same love. Love one another. Love people in this world enough to tell them about Jesus. Love them enough to tell them, even when they refuse you, even when they reject you, even when they want to kill you for telling them about Christ, tell them about Christ because you love him and you love them. Persons walking in darkness are opposed to themselves. They don't understand. They don't see it yet because they don't have a relationship with him yet. Don't give up. Don't stop. Keep planting. Keep watering. Give the rest to God, but don't stop. Interesting thing about, and I heard this, and I don't know, it's kind of interesting. We could talk about apples. There's apples in the kitchen. They're pretty good. But, you know, I heard that apples weren't native to America. They got brought here. And yet, have you ever been to Wenatchee? You've been to Kennewick? You've seen the apple orchards and just beautiful apples and just, they're so delicious in so many different kinds. Somebody planted. Somebody watered. God gave the increase. Be that. Be that person. Fill up your apple seed bag with the word of God and get out there and start planting. And let God deal with the rest of it. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you and praise you for your goodness, mercy, love, kindness, and compassion toward us. Lord, we thank you. Use us today, Lord. Give us boldness to get out and tell people about you, to plant and to water this wonderful, wonderful gospel that you have given to us. Our Savior dying for us, being our heavenly high priest, giving his life, Lord, on the cross, and now ever living to make intercession for us. We thank you. We thank you that there's a day coming that Christ is coming for us, and we look forward to that day. We look for him, and we wait for him. But we don't wait idly, Lord. We get out, and we tell people about you, and we live this glorious gospel. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Asking the worship team to come back up one more time, we're going to sing hymn number 257, What a Wonderful Savior. If you would turn in your hymnals, you can stand and sing with us. Hymn 257, What a Wonderful Savior.
Christ has for sin atonement made, what a wonderful Savior. We are redeemed, the price is paid, what a wonderful Savior. What a wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Jesus. What a
dismissed in prayer here in a moment, but after service, worship team will meet right over there, if right that way. Okay, praise the Lord. Oh yeah, and food. There's lots of food here. There's lots of food that's being patiently prepared. Amen. There is a lot of food here, so please stay and have a bite. It's great, and we'll get to fellowship with each other. So praise the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I do thank you again so much for your goodness, mercy, love, kindness, compassion to all of us. Lord, I ask that your blessings would be upon the food that is being prepared in the kitchen right now, those that are working hard to bring those things to all of us. What a blessing that is. Thank you, Lord. I also thank you, Lord, for each one that's here today. And I pray that you would speak and continue to speak to our hearts about the necessity for us to get out and tell people about you. Lord, we thank you for this great joy that we have in salvation. We thank you for this great joy that we have as we look forward to the return of Christ. We don't know the day or the hour, but you do, Lord. And until that day, I pray that we be faithful in doing the job that you've called us and commanded us to do, to go and preach Christ to this world. And we just thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you.